Okay, friends, now we have already seen RTTI, we have seen how useful it is. Now we are going to see one very important operator called dynamic cast and three other operators which are not all that critical, but dynamic cast is very, very critical because it is being used with RTTI. We will be talking about all four casting operators in this particular module. Okay, we will extend our discussions of RTTI and throw light on this this operators. There are three operators: static cast, reinterpret cast, and const cast. They are extending C style casting in C++, especially ANSI C++, which was extended in 98. Dynamic cast is very important. Now, dynamic cast, remember our downcasting example. Dynamic cast actually cast one type of pointer into the other only if it is relevant and not otherwise. Okay. So, that's the reason why it is very, very critical, and dynamic cast operates only on polymorphic object pointers or references and nothing else, and we will see how to work with that. Okay. And the great thing about dynamic cast is it's most flexible. You do not need to like worry about the hierarchy. You change the hierarchy, the code won't change. That's the power of dynamic cast, and we'll look at an example. Okay. It can actually replace multiple type ID comparisons. Okay. Static cast is used for normal C type casting. Reinterpret cast is something which is used for unconventional pointer to integer or integer to pointer kind of casting issues. And const cast is a strange cast introduced. What does it do? It will convert a non-const but convert it to const kind of value. They are called contextual const values into non-const values. Okay, we'll see all examples of all of them to understand. Okay, consider a case that we have already seen in the previous module. We had this: if type ID R news is type ID text, then we'll do we'll enable printing. But then, what if the text is also inherited into HTML text and RTF text, two more classes? Okay, now the hierarchy is extended. I need to extend this. Is a type ID R news is text, or R news is S text, HTML text, or RTF text? Any one of them is true, then enable print, otherwise not. Now, this is a tricky business. Now, what if this HTML text inherit into OML, Open XML and XML? Okay. If it is inherited into two more class, again we'll have to go and hack into this program and add two more lines. That is troublesome. Okay. Programmer needs to modify the code every then when this happens. Okay. When one type goes out of favor, when suppose later on we will not have any H text, we'll need to remove that. We do not remove that, comparison will anyway take place and will eat unnecessary CPU cycles, and we do not want that, we will have to remove that code. So, that kind of alterations are always needed in the code, which is not a good thing. So, what is the solution to it? The dynamic cast is the answer to that problem. So, let us first of all understand what dynamic cast is. It is a cast designed to deal with multiple polymorphic objects. So, converting a pointer to one polymorphic object into the other, casting them, is done by dynamic cast, and that is done only if it is really worth doing. It is when a pointer is pointing to that object, then fine, otherwise not. Okay. If the pointer is actually pointing to that object or any object inherited from it, remember any pointer can always point to a derived object. So, it is casted only if it is the destination object is of the same type or any type derived from it, then and then it is casting is possible, otherwise not. The syntax is though quite cryptic. Okay. So, P shape is a pointer to shape. Now, I want to cast that thing into a P square. I want to do it. So, normally what I do is I will use something like this. P square equal to square star, now this is a C type casting, P shape, Okay, this is normally I do. When I write this, it will convert a P shape pointer into a P square. It casts the same pointer into this. And this is only good if P shape is actually pointing to a derived class. Otherwise, this is going to create something quite unmeaningful. Okay, so fine. So, if that is to be done, I can use instead dynamic cast. So, instead of writing square star in the normal bracket, I use dynamic underscore cast in angular bracket, the type of pointer I want to provide. So, square, not square star, square. Okay. So, what does this do? Will cast this P shape into P square, simple. But only if P shape is pointing to a valid square object and not otherwise. Okay. It is quite possible that there are few other classes derived from P square and P shape is pointing to that class. In that case, it is possible to be casted, okay, because that is valid. P square can always point to any object of square type or any class derived from it. So, in that case, it is allowed and not otherwise. What will it do if this fails? If this is a pointer, it will return a null pointer. So, you will have to check whether the dynamic cast returns a null pointer. If you get a null pointer, you take an evasive action. If it is a reference, okay, reference, you do not get a null reference actually. There is no concept of null reference. So, whenever you are casting a reference, you will have to see if there is an exception thrown. Okay, you will have to use that try catch and see if there is an exception thrown, and that is called bad cast. Okay, so if that bad cast exception is thrown, you will have to take an evasive action. We will see how that is done. Okay, so the same thing which I talked about, pointer to derived class can be casted into base only if base class pointer sub object. Okay, sorry, is a pointer to derived can be converted to a base class pointer. Obviously, that is allowed because all derived class object contains a base class sub object. So, whenever that pointer is made to point to it, it will actually point to the base class sub object embedded inside the derived class sub object. But the other way around, pointer to a base class can be casted into derived class only if it is actually pointing to a derived class object or any other object of the derived class of the derived object, further derived class. Okay. Dynamic casting using this dynamic cast is safe now, because if it is not appropriate, it will not cast and return an error, a null pointer or a bad cast exception. Casting, when you use dynamic casting, it will only do for a pointer or a reference, will not do for an object, will not cast. Okay. So, here is again the very class hierarchy that we are quite used to now, a shape class and then virtual void draw, okay, something that we already seen, the circle constructor, then again a virtual draw, then a square, again a constructor here, and then a draw, okay, a virtual function, same. Now, quite interesting, here are some objects of different classes and pointers to them are defined. Now, what, let us try to see what is happening here. I have a pointer to a shape class object. I want to convert that thing or cast that thing to a shape class pointer. Shape class to shape class, logically speaking, should be allowed and dynamic cast allows it. Similarly, here it is circle to circle, should be allowed, circle to circle actually here, it is allowed. Okay. Shape to square. This may not be allowed. If not allowed, I will get this thing. What I am doing is I am actually testing for a null this thing. If the null pointer, then it is not done. If it is not null pointer, then it is done. So, I am actually testing whether this is done or not. And then again, circle to shape. Okay. If it is done, yes, not otherwise. Shape is pointing to square. Now, this is a important thing. This is allowed or not. And when it is pointing to shape, whether that is allowed or not. Okay, circle to circle and circle to shape. The answer is this: shape to shape allowed, circle to circle allowed, obviously it is logical. No shape to square pointer is allowed, obviously. Why? Because shape pointer, you have taken an object of a pointer to actually a shape object itself. So, when we are casting to circle pointer, it should not be allowed, and that is right. Circle to shape is also allowed. We have a pointer to circle, okay. The pointer to shape, now that is converted, that is allowed. But when P shape points to an object of square, the other is also allowed. Shape to square is allowed, okay. A pointer to shape converts to pointer to square allowed. Here pointer to circle to pointer to shape was not allowed. Here it is allowed because it is actually pointing to square. When it is pointing to T shape, it is not allowed. Okay. When it is pointing to P circle, is pointing to a circle object, I can actually cast that thing to P shape, that is allowed. Okay. But then in that case, the P shape will only access the top part or the shape sub object of it. Okay. Now, look at the code with dynamic cast. I had multiple type id r news double equal to type id text, then type id h text, then type id all that. We had 3-4 statements. Now, all of them are converted into the single statement. It says that r news is casted into text. Okay. Now, dynamic cast is successful only if the r news is actually pointing to either text or any class derived from its h text or rtf or whatever. Okay. Then and then this is done. Even if hierarchy changes, it does not make any difference to it, because it just says that any class derived from it. And that it does on the basis of the hierarchy at runtime. If the hierarchy is really huge, this dynamic cast statement will take a lot of time executing, and that is the overhead, but that is the power also. I do not need to change the code even if my hierarchy is big or small or whatever, okay, and I will just do it. And because it is basically an operator, this is reference. As I said, if it is a reference, then if the r news is not derived from text or text itself, then this casting, this dynamic casting is going to fail, and the dynamic casting is going to fail is going to throw an exception called bad cast. Okay. So, I am embedding this thing into try, and in the case I will take care of the bad cast and my job is done. Now, this is how the process with dynamic cast is done. What is the advantage of using a dynamic cast? Okay. Serif of type id are replaced by a single dynamic cast statement. A single statement checks for all classes. I do not need to specify class 1, text, r text, whatever, I do not need to. A single statement does everything. Okay. And check continues working for a changed hierarchy, because the statement, my dynamic cast just converts one type of pointer into the other irrespective of what the hierarchy is. It depends on the hierarchy, but does not require to specify me what the hierarchy is. So, if the hierarchy changes outside the context of this particular statement, absolutely fine with it. We do not need to make any changes to the program itself, and that is very, very great solution. And that also helps a library designer to code independent of the hierarchy of the library user. Okay. And that is again an advantage here. Okay. And here, suppose if I take two cases and I just call this right click function, in case number 1 says enable printing, in the second case it says won't. Okay. Okay, now let us look at the remaining three different three types of casting. Remember, as I said, UNCC++ committee added four different types of casting operations. Dynamic cast is the most critical and most important, but then there are three others. One typical is called const cast. Const cast is there to convert a const item into non-const. Surprising? Yes, it is. But then const is not a conventional const that you have already seen, that is called contextual const. Now, it is always a good idea to code like this. Suppose if I say my function some emp department d and do something. Now, this is basically a value parameter passing job. I am passing an employee object as well as a department object, and if these objects are big, this function will take lot of time getting executed. And if I dislike doing it, okay, you may say that I use a pointer either or a reference. Okay, I use a reference. Either of that will solve the problem because I don't need to pass big objects to it. But then there is a problem, because if I change something in E or D somewhere in the code, will reflect it back in the main program, and that is the very purpose of using value parameter passing, that whatever function does is the caller function's code is not affected by it. That is a great service. But okay, so what is the solution? Solution is to say const. Okay, I just say const this thing, my job is done. Because the items that I am specifying are const, the references are const. So, if somebody changes that constant, it is not going to be reflected, because it is basically const. But now, this const cast actually can threaten this kind of programming. Why? Because it can actually, and such constants, which are basically these values, are not basically constant. They get constness upon the entry of them into the function. Okay. Before that, they were not constant. They are not true constants actually. They are called contextual constants, and that is the difference between normal constant and this contextual constant. Contextual constants can be converted into non-const and can be operated, and I'll just show you an example. See that. Now, this is a function called dangerous function. And I call this thing dangerous purposefully. Now, I pass const int reference ti1, that is passed to this function. I define one more reference ti2, an integer reference, and I const cast that thing, okay, this into it, and then I increment it. Now, this is pretty dangerous. See, if you are a programmer, you will just get this prototype function which gets const int reference, and you pass an integer value to it, call the function passing an integer parameter to it. After that, you assume that the integer parameter, whatever has happened to in that function, the integer parameter value is not changed. Unfortunately, this code actually changes it. See, again, let us try to understand. This is the constant, seemingly contextual constant. Value is passed, it is casted into non-const reference, and that non-const reference is incremented. The value anyway is incremented. So, now the effect of this is quite interesting. I have two values. One is a normal integer with value 10 and a constant integer with value 10, and I am calling dangerous function for both of them. What the output is? The value of i1 is 10 and i2 is 10 before calling the function. After calling the function, i1 remains 10 because it is actually constant, but i2 is not actually constant, it is a contextual constant, will change to 11. Okay. And this is the power of const cast. The other one The next one is called static cast. Now, that is used for replacing conventional C-type casting. A conventional C-type casting is used in almost all cases that we write programs like int I, then long L, something like equal to long, something like this. Okay, I'm casting it, or the other way around. Both are acceptable. Okay, I'm casting I into long. Okay, so both ways are. So either if I use this, sorry. Okay, something like this. So, whenever a conventional normal casting is done, static cast is good, but not always it is so that you need such casting. Sometimes you need to trick into doing something like this, and you might need to have p equal to, you might have int I equal to some address, int star I. Okay. So, whatever that address that you have specified, your pointer now should put address to that location. So, you just convert that value into int star. Now, this is a typical casting an integer into a pointer. Now, that is not normal, not conventional. So, static cast is to be used for this and not for this. So, if you do this, there is an example provided. So, an integer to float, I use static cast float this way. So, this integer is to be casted into a float, and that is returned here. This is allowed. I can't convert an integer into int star, I'll get a compilation error. If I write uncomment this statement, my program will not compile. Okay. Exactly opposite to it, we have something called a reinterpret cast. Reinterpret cast is to be used for the case which I was talking about, when you are converting an integer into a pointer. Okay. I will not be able to use static cast here, and I will not be able to use reinterpret cast for converting a static an integer pointer into a float, or integer into a float or something. So, reinterpret cast, I cannot convert integer into float, but then I can convert integer into an int star. Okay. So, I have got this thing called reinterpret cast. So, instead of casting in C like fashion, I should use reinterpret cast. What is the advantage of these two additional operators that are provided? It will tell you, as a programmer, if you want to do conventional casting, you should use static cast. If you do not want to use conventional casting, you want to use some unconventional casting, use reinterpret cast. The problem comes in when you use a C type casting is that you want something which is natural, but unfortunately, because you mistype something, it cast into something which you do not want. In, for example, suppose if you want to convert something into int something, okay, but unfortunately you somehow introduce star here, C++ will not realize that you have made a mistake and will convert that even that thing, cast that thing into a pointer, and obviously the consequences are pretty serious, which you do not really understand. So, if your program, if you are fortunate, your program will start misbehaving immediately, and you realize that there is something wrong, and most probably it is associated with the latest changes that you have made with the program, you will be able to rectify that. But if the program does not start misbehaving immediately, because you are not testing the case where this statement is executed, will start throwing errors at later periods and confusing you and troubling you like never before. So, such an error is very, very hard to catch. Okay. And that is the reason why C++ standardization committee has provided this. So, if you really want to do an int cast, you probably would use static cast. And then if you by mistake add a star to it, the program will not compile, and you will know there and then that this is an error. And you will remove it and the program works fine. If you really want to do something unconventional, you specify it by typing it as reinterpret cast. when you specify reinterpret cast, you clearly conveying that I want to interstar.
Okay.
And if you do something else, we'll say that no, you're not doing it actually. So both ways is going to be helpful for us. So that's the reason why this are added. And this is what I'm talking about. There's a difference between normal and abnormal operations, and we are dealing with normal operation, we should use static cast. We're dealing with abnormal operations, we should use the reinterpret cast. If you're dealing with const related, you'll use const cast. If you're dealing with polymorphic objects, we'll use dynamic cast. Okay, so normal C type casting is not recommended any longer. You should use this type of casting if ever you need to use them in your programs. So RTTI, yes, there is one more thing, as I mentioned that thing earlier, that RTTI can also be used with templates. So before we conclude, we'll look at this how RTTI can be used with templates. You can see this thing. Suppose if I have a function called type and there is something that I like to do. Okay, so if I say that the type ID type is integer, I'll provide integer validation. If it is character, I'll provide character validation. If provide something character pointer, then I'll provide character validation. And after that, I'll have a search module which is generic. Now that helps me, okay, because I still can write my generic code, but I can still add some points which I would like to have specific for specific types. And now that's the advantage of using type-based validations in templates. Okay. In fact, you can do something additional also. You can also match two generic types. Okay. This is the case where there are two things. One is the item that you are searching, and the other item that user provide to search in that array. When these two items do not match, we have a problem. As I have told you, the type matching is very, very stringent in templates. So, you can actually define them as different types and then check whether these two types are the same and provide an error rather than breaking it in the middle. Okay. So, that kind of possibility is there if you use RTTI with this thing. There is something called cross casting. Quite interesting. I have a pointer, the Indian cricketer is Indian as well as cricketer. So, it is like this. I have Indian, I have cricketer, I have Indian cricketer. Now, Indian cricketer obviously can be pointed to by either a pointer to Indian or a cricketer, because both of them are base classes of it. And interestingly, whenever I have a pointer Indian which is pointing to an Indian cricketer, can be casted to a pointer to cricketer, okay, because it is basically pointing to this object. That is called cross casting. And now that also is made safe using dynamic cast. So, you can cast this dynamically into this only if it is pointing to a multiply derived object and not otherwise. So, there is an example given here. So, you can do something like this, pre-cricketer equal to pre-Indian. This is cross casting, which is pretty dangerous, but you can say pre-cricketer is equal to dynamic cast cricketer star p-Indian. Now, so p-Indian is casted into cricketer pointer p-cricketer only if it is pointing to a derived class object and not otherwise. Okay, and you should actually have this is a pointer, so you should check whether the pre-cricketer is a null. If it is null, it is not casted, and you should display appropriate error message. But the safer cross casting is also possible with this thing, the RTTI. So with that note, we'll conclude our module on RTTI and casting operations. What we have seen in this module are four different types of casting operators provided by ANSI C++: dynamic cast, static cast, const cast, and reinterpret cast. We have seen that dynamic cast is used for polymorphic objects, const cast is used to cast contextual constant, non-constant into non-constant, static cast for doing normal C type casting operations, reinterpret cast is to cast uncommon operation of casting like converting an int into instar and so on. With that note, we will conclude our discussion on RTTI and casting operations. Thank you, friends.